I shared with you last week from 1 Corinthians 1, 17 and 18. I want to start off again with that, because this is the purpose that the Lord has laid upon my heart for these next few weeks, and that being the purpose of the cross. But 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 17 and 18. I'm going to ask you to stand with me. We're just going to read two verses and then pray. We're going to be looking at a few other verses here this morning, but I want you to grasp this purpose here, not just for today, but for the coming weeks, and that this is a purpose that we'll never lose. We'll never lose this purpose. But Paul says to the Corinthians, "For Christ did not send me to baptize, but to preach the gospel, not with wisdom and eloquence, lest the cross of Christ be emptied of its power. For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God." Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord. We thank you for the cross. Lord Jesus, we thank you for being that person, that one who went to the cross and died for us. And so, Lord, we ask now, Lord, that within our life, within our individual lives, Lord, that your cross would not be emptied of its power, but that today, Lord God, we would renew our focus, we'd renew our understanding and faith in you, Jesus, and that we would know who you, the person of the cross, is and will always be. So, Lord, I pray now, bless this time, anoint my lips, anoint our ears, Lord, that we will hear your word, Lord God, and we will know your truth. We pray this in your name, Jesus. Amen. 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 You may be seated. If you want to, you can go ahead and kind of put your finger or put a bookmark in Isaiah chapter 52, Isaiah 52 and 53, and we're going to be looking at that very, very hallmark passage of God's word. But I want you to, first of all, I want you to consider the possibility of what Paul was saying here to the Corinthians. That he was offering a caution, a warning. He was reminding himself of what the Lord had sent him to do, and that was to preach the gospel, and to do so that the cross would not be emptied of its power. And I want you to consider that possibility. The cross, void of power. Consider that possibility. You say, well, that would be impossible. The cross of Christ, God's love and Jesus' sacrifice will never lose its power. But Paul is sharing that there is that possibility that in our lives, in our outlook, in our attitudes, that the cross could be emptied of its power. Our approach to the cross would be such that it's just mundane. It's just going through the motions. And so as I've encountered this in these last few months, I want you to know, personally, I've gone through just a search of God's word and a quest, if you will, to say, Lord, I want to know the full magnitude of your cross. And as a pastor, and as I've read these words from God's word and from the Apostle Paul, and as we'll be looking at the words of the prophet Isaiah, to understand that, Lord, we want your cross. We want you, Lord Jesus, your fullness to fill us. We don't want to be empty. You know, it's not so much that the cross is emptied of its power, but our life is emptied of the power of Christ. And so as we look at this and we understand what Paul's saying, that for unbelievers, for those who, they hear the gospel and they just don't believe, they just pass it off as it's foolishness. That's just crazy. The whole idea of my sins and the need for forgiveness is just foolishness, is how the unbelieving world looks at. It just doesn't make any sense. And again, they're perishing because of that disbelief and that attitude that it's not true, it's not for me, it's not necessary, and so they're perishing. But for those who, it says, are being saved, and that understand that perpetuating faith, being saved. You know, sometimes again, where can we start to in our life have the power of the cross being emptied is when we look at it as it's something in the past. Oh yeah, I'm saved. I've been saved. But we need to take the attitude and the outlook that we are being saved. It's perpetual. It's continuing. And that attitude that the power of Christ and the cross is continuing to fill my life. You say, well, I have a faith. I've had a faith for years, but are you losing focus? Or even forgetting the emphasis of the gospel and what it means, and losing sight of Jesus, losing sight of seeing the person of the cross. And so today we want to. We would just want to come back to that place where we see the person of the Christ. Throughout God's word, we're told to behold, to see. John the Baptist, he said to those that were listening when he saw Jesus approaching, he said, "Behold the Lamb of God who taketh away the sin of the world." And see, it's him. It's not me. And Isaiah, we're going to see, Isaiah says, "Behold." Behold the one. Behold the one. And so today, again, we want to look at what is perhaps one of the greatest visual passages of God's word. That's Isaiah 53. But we're going to focus on Isaiah 52, the last three verses, because that's really the beginning of this great passage. You've heard me tell you a lot of times, the chapters, the verses, those aren't inspired by God. God's word tells us all scripture is given by inspiration. It's the words, all right? Not the chapters and the verses. Those weren't inspired by God. Those were the idea of man so that you can easily look up a portion of scripture, that a pastor can say, take your Bibles and turn to such and such a book, such and such a chapter, such and such a verse. So that's a convenience thing, if you will. But this great chapter of Isaiah 53 really begins in chapter 52. And it's often called Song of the Suffering Servant. It's God's revelation of the Messiah, his servant and his son, and the Messiah's vicarious sacrifice and victorious salvation that he brings. So turn with me there in your Bibles to Isaiah chapter 52. Isaiah chapter 52. I want to share with you the last three verses. We're not going to be reading all of chapter 53. I'll highlight some things from Isaiah 53. But I want you to see these three verses in Isaiah chapter 52. This great song. It actually, in a way, begins with the end. The Messiah's accomplished work. Isaiah 53, it speaks of all that Christ suffered. Again, I call it the Song of the Suffering Servant. But Isaiah 52, verses 13 through 15, highlights the victory, if you will, highlights what is going to be at the end, and then after the Messiah's accomplished work. And he begins it by saying, "Behold." Behold, see. And so this morning, let us see the fullness of Jesus Christ, the person of the cross. Isaiah, his words go like this: "See, my servant will act wisely. He will be raised and lifted up and highly exalted. Just as there were many who were appalled at him, his appearance was so disfigured beyond that of any human being, and his form marred beyond human likeness, so he will sprinkle many nations, and kings will shut their mouths because of him. For what they were not told, they will see, and what they have not heard, they will understand. But this is Isaiah, the prophet, God's messenger, saying, behold my servant. Behold my servant. And today we want to see Jesus Christ. Today I want you to behold the servant. I want you to behold Jesus Christ. And you say, well, again, I've seen Jesus. I know Jesus. But let us make sure that the power of the person of the cross is not emptied in our lives. Let us be sure that his fullness is filling our lives with his power. So from Isaiah 52, verses 13 through 15, let us see the person of the cross. First of all, I want you to see the unbelievable servant. I want you to see the unbelievable servant. Isaiah says, see my servant. Behold my servant. This is God speaking through Isaiah to the people of Israel. And he's saying, behold, see my servant. See the unbelievable servant, the Messiah. We need to understand the Messiah has a very unique identity. A very unique identity. That he is God and he is servant. And I can't help but believe that this passage from Isaiah was what the Apostle Paul was focusing on, was concentrating on, and that then the Holy Spirit spoke to Paul, and Paul began to write down inspired words that he wrote in a letter to the Philippians. And again, it's another very familiar passage of Scripture, a hallmark passage of Scripture, if you will, from Philippians chapter 2. And Paul, as I got to believe he was thinking of the words given through Isaiah that said, behold, my servant. Behold, this is the Messiah, the one who's going to become. He is my servant. And Paul began to write down these words. I want you to see them. They're in Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 through 8. Hear these words. Hear these words that Paul writes down. He says, the same mindset of Christ Jesus, who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness and being found in appearance as a man. He humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Here's the unique identity of this unbelievable servant, that he, being in very nature God. Jesus is God. He always has been. The Trinity, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, in very nature God. Jesus is God. And yet this unique identity as God, that he put it aside, and then it says, by taking the very nature of a servant as well. God and servant, God and man. And so Isaiah is saying, behold my servant, and Paul, as the Holy Spirit is filling his life and inspiring him, he speaks of this, and he's saying, behold Jesus Christ, the very nature of God and the very nature of a servant, one and the same. And again, the unbelievable servant, that is God himself becoming servant of man. I mean, it's hard to comprehend. And we, as we, again, see the person of the cross, God himself dying on the cross. By nature God and by nature servant. We need to see the person of the cross, God and man together. Number two, we want to see the unequaled success. I want you to see the unequaled success of that person on the cross. Verse 13, see, he says, see my servant. It says he will be raised and lifted up and highly exalted. I told you that the song of the suffering servant, it starts out with the end. It starts out with what's going to ultimately take place. And then from there, it goes in, and throughout chapter 53, it talks about the suffering that Jesus would endure as he gave his life. But we're told here, he will be raised and lifted up and highly exalted. I want you to see, this is unequaled success. No one has prospered and been exalted as Jesus Christ. And again, it says, what we see here is we see the resurrection, we see the ascension, and we see the glorification of Jesus Christ. That he, again, it's going to get into his sacrifice throughout Isaiah 53 there. We're going to get to that. But we're seeing here that this is going to be the outcome, that he is exalted above all others. He is exalted above all others, resurrected, ascended, glorified. And even verse 15, it says that kings will shut their mouths because of him. We see that speechless amazement. There's going to come that time when the Lord comes in all of his glory, that kings and dignitaries, they're going to bow down in speechless amazement, because they'll see it was all true. It was all true, the Son of God. But here again, I got to believe that the Apostle Paul, as he was focusing there again, and the Holy Spirit inspiring him to write this letter to the Philippians, when you continue on in chapter 2 with verses 9 to 11, here again, what Paul says, that echoes what the prophet Isaiah is highlighting here about the servant. Verse 9, Philippians chapter 2, therefore God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The highest exaltation. Again, behold my servant. He will be raised and lifted up and highly exalted. See the unequaled success, the unequaled exaltation that will be for Jesus Christ. Thirdly, I want you to see the person of the cross. I want you to see the unimaginable suffering. Oh yeah, we need to focus on that. The unimaginable suffering. What does it say here, verse 14? That they were appalled at him. His appearance was so disfigured beyond that of any human being, and that his form marred beyond human likeness. Jesus, what he suffered there upon the cross. I mean, we need to understand, he really couldn't even be looked at. That the pain and the beatings that he took, the suffering that he went through, it's unimaginable. We can't even comprehend it. And we say, we don't want to talk about that, Pastor. Why do we got to talk about? Well, we need to understand. We need to see the person of the cross. We need to see that suffering that Jesus. Why? Because he did it for you and I. He did it for you and I. Understand that it's equivalent to the suffering that we deserve to go through. It's what our penalty for our sin should be, that we would suffer to that extent. He did it for us. He did it for us. And again, people even will avoid this passage of Scripture churches will avoid it. My biggest concern right now, and especially in our country, in our nation, is in our churches, that we're not preaching the person of the cross. You know, everybody wants to feel good. Everybody wants to, they just want to, have that image that everything is well. And again, God gives us peace and joy and gives us hope. But folks, we need to remember that what Jesus did, the unimaginable suffering, that is, he was that person. He took on the very nature of you and I. He took on our nature. He took on our sin. And as the video highlighted there, that to the point that even God would not look upon his son Jesus, because God cannot look upon sin. And we talk about the physical suffering. The physical suffering was nothing to that of the suffering that Jesus experienced, because he took on our sin. He took on our sin. And folks, here's the reality of it, that as we choose when in Corinthians, when Paul said that for the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, we need to understand that perishing is the suffering that will be one day for all who choose to not believe in God's Son, Jesus Christ. That there will be that unimaginable suffering for those who will perish, because their sin remains upon them and isn't cleansed by the blood of Christ, isn't covered by the person of the cross. It will be unimaginable suffering for those who are cast from the presence of God, cast from his kingdom. And so, again, we should see the unimaginable suffering that Christ went through, because that could be you and I, but for the grace of God and for the blood of Jesus Christ. And so we see here, as we see the person of the cross, we see the unbelievable servant, we see the unequaled success, we see the unimaginable suffering. Maybe we want to try to, turn our eyes from that. We don't want to think about that, but it's part of it. But finally, we want to see in the person of the cross, we want to see the unmatched sacrifice. Unmatched sacrifice. We say, what do you mean unmatched? There has been no sacrifice like the sacrifice Jesus paid for you and I. Oh, there's been lots of sacrifices. We look at the Old Testament. We see the sacrificial system that was provided by God there, that whether it be kind of animal that was sacrificed for in place of the people for their sin, for their offering, whatever it may be. You can go back. When you read through Leviticus there, and you see the many types of sacrifices. And we don't have time to go through all that, but these were part of the sacrifices that God provided, so man would know forgiveness, would know the presence of God. But we need to understand that that the servant of God, Jesus Christ, the person on the cross, we need to see the unmatched sacrifice, that his sacrifice, one sacrifice for sin. And not just for sin, but for our sin. Our sin. And not just our sin, but for all our sin. The video, used some numbers that we can't even begin to comprehend. 15 billion people that Jesus sacrificed his life for. But again, he sacrificed for you. Narrow it down. He sacrificed for you. Unmatched sacrifice. It says there, in verse 15, that it says just as there were many who were appalled at him, and of course his appearance and his form, but it says, so he will sprinkle many nations. There's that that visual, if you will, that his blood was shed and sprinkled for many, for all. Unmatched sacrifice. Sacrifice for all. Jesus experienced hell so you and I won't have to. Won't have to. Jesus went to hell so we could go to heaven. And Jesus was that person on the cross, but he rose again. And he ascended, and he will be glorified. He will be glorified. The victory will be there. Today, again, I want you to be able to see the person of Isaiah 52 and 53, the person of the cross. And so we can even now, we can look at Isaiah chapter 52 here, and we can insert Jesus' name in there. We can insert Jesus' name there. He said, see my servant Jesus. He will act wisely. Jesus will be raised and lifted up and highly exalted, just as there were many who were appalled at him, just as there are many that are appalled at Jesus today. His appearance so disfigured beyond that of any human being, and his form marred beyond human likeness, so Jesus will sprinkle his blood on many nations. He'll sprinkle his blood on you and I. And kings will shut their mouths because of him. They'll be speechless because of him. For what they were told about Jesus, they will see. And what they have not heard about Jesus, they will understand. See the person of the cross. I'd like the worship team to come back at this time. See the person of the cross. See the servant. See the Messiah. See the Savior. See Jesus.